What is going on, everyone? It is time for that Bleach special chapter review of 686.5 or 687. Whatever you would like to call it, we'll find out as the future goes on. Because many of the questions that people are asking, is there going to be an arc or more chapters after this? And I've already done a video on that, but we'll touch upon that a bit more later on down the chapter. Now, of course, this is a review and I will give my overall thoughts on it. But there are many questions and queries that I have about this chapter. And many of the criticisms that I have with this chapter specifically are more to do with the translations more than the actual chapter itself, which is unfortunate because there is a lot of confusion between the scanlation part of the chapter and the official Viz part of the scanlations as well. So we're going to try and address those as best as we can throughout this review, and also talk about some tidbits, some theories as well within the chapter as well, just to give this video a little bit more depth. But first and foremost, what did I think of this chapter? Nothing short but a 10 out of 10. And to be honest with you, there is a lot of people that would agree with that. Even people who are very critical of Bleach have come to the notion that this was a great chapter, and I don't think anyone can argue with that. You had a nice setup where we get to see all the characters, what they're up to. You have a great foundation with the chapter, specifically talking about what this chapter is going to be about. Something harmless, something customary, and something that brings something back from the past, from the Falcy and Blood War arc, and bringing it to the current events of the aftermath of those effects that happened during that time, and really solidifying some extra lore into the Soul Society that we as old Bleach fans can really appreciate and still to this day learn more about. Being that the foundation of this chapter is going to be called the Konso Reisai by Viz translation, or Bogo in its literal translation, the Soul Funeral Festival, which festivals are supposed to be cheery, but I guess in this context, I guess kind of makes sense that there is a lot of... It doesn't matter. And that's all this chapter needed to do, was give a simple ceremony like that and escalate it by tenfold, because that's exactly what happened. Old fans got to learn about the repercussions of what happened the last time we touched Bleach 5 years ago, and bringing it to now, as I've already said, and then bring in a new concept, which is very interesting. Now, what are the repercussions, you might ask? Well, of course, if you haven't read the chapter, which you should have, this festival is in regards to Jushiro Ukitake, one of the three captains that died within the Soul Society. Genryu Sai Yamamoto being the first one, Retsu Unohana being the second, and Jushiro Ukitake being the last and final one to have their funeral 12 years after their death. Because apparently, in its layman's terms, high spiritual pressure with that much density cannot be returned to the soil of the Soul Society or the Buddhism ideology of reincarnation in its, again, layman's terms. Don't be over specific with it, please, in the comment section. This ritual is to allow that spiritual energy or that dense spiritual energy to be able to be passed on and to be able to be with one with the earth. So the Soul Society is supposedly taught. However, we come to quotation, come to learn that that isn't the case, and we'll talk about that in a minute. This ritual requires a hollow to be killed in front of the grave of the Soul Reaper that is going to be passed on, and thus the lieutenants go over to the world of the living to go find a hollow, or the captains stay at the grave and make preparations. However, during this time where the lieutenants go to the world of the living, they are met with a bunch of hollow looking creatures, which are not hollows at all. They are called, by Viz's translation, beasts, but by the other scanlations are called ghouls. Again, we'll talk about that in a minute. They fight these monsters, and we come to find a familiar face rise up from the grounds of hell, from a hell portal known as Xylopodo Grant. This is an old espada of which Renji, Uryu, and Mayuri defeated, and has come to say hello once more to not really fight, but seem to give a bit of a warning. Maybe. We're not quite sure of his motive yet. We come to learn that his hollow hole has closed, and this hollow hole has become an outside external hole, if that makes sense. Kind of, where he is, I guess he gets a new transformation, which again we can talk about later on, where his hatred and sadness and fear and lonesomeness, all those emotions are made external, and thus these goat horns seem to arise from his brain, giving a literal manifestation of going out of his head and turning into something external. Okay, interesting. Obviously Renji's getting away because Ichika is in the front fire and his fatherly instincts kick in. Ichigo comes in, swipes the chains of hell, and so Ichigo and Xylopora fight for a brief moment. We get some exposition from Kyoraku talking about this is an essence from hell. So then we get Kyoraku talk about the superstition, or the old wives' tale about the ritual itself, and that the fact that it is quite possible that the ritual actually does something else other than return the Soul Reaper's energy into the soul and into the land, to which is then cut off by Xylopora, saying that Soul Reapers have been sending their comrades all the way to hell, and thus Xylopora gets stabbed with Ukitake's sword, to which he says, "You're a bit early, Jushiro Ukitake, and then he makes the statement that the ritual is over and that he already killed in front of Jushiro himself, in front of Jushiro Zoa, showing the Shinigami Soul Reaper badge. And then, yeah, the gates close and we see Kazuri run in another shot, and then, oh, the Hellverse arc continues, supposedly. There's your rundown. You've read the chapter. Let's talk about what I'm interested in the most. Before I talk about the theories and the interesting bits I want to talk about, I also want to talk about the criticisms. There is a lot of criticisms in regards to translations, which would confuse many people, especially for people who are interested in the lore, such as myself. For the majority of the chapter, the context of the translations are very good and very easy to follow up. However, there are very specific things which I have issues with. For example, what are the monsters that the Soul Reapers are fighting? Are they ghouls or are they beasts? After speaking to a few good amount of translators, and I suppose Japanese people who are, you know, in Japan, it is seemingly that they are called ghouls rather than Viz's translation of beasts. And why this bothers me a lot is because these beasts technically already exist, and that's Komamura's clan, which are a race of beasts or animals. So to call that these monsters beasts would be not the same as Komamura's type, which causes confusion. So in fact, that these monsters are actually being called ghouls and they're not hollows. However, do I believe that they were once hollows? It's quite possible. Going off what Xylopro had to say, with the hollow hole becoming an external thing and then becoming that big like halo thing behind Xylopro, which would follow in conjunction to what these ghouls look like, right? Because they all seem to have spherical anomalies within their body. And what I'm saying is that, okay, well, if hollows who go to hell have their hollow holes turned into this spherical thing outside their bodies, then what happens to Shinigamis who don't have hollow holes? What happens to them? What change happens to Soul Reapers or Shinigamis? So Viz Media, the whole beast thing, I think was a poor choice of wording. Another nitpicking translation from Viz is gallows. The word gallows was used instead of warden. So the gallows of hell are clairvoyant, which again is very interesting because clairvoyancy means you can see into the future. But the gallows are something that, you know, execute. You know, the gallows are those big, you know, executioner platforms. Whereas the scanlation says warden, which is a more correct translation. And it would be better to say that the wardens are clairvoyant or all seeing in the scanlation unofficial translation. So again, Viz, I'm not convinced with the gallows, because that makes no sense compared to warden. A gallow is a thing while a warden is a something or a person. So to say a warden is all seeing would make more sense than the gallows of hell. Again, it depends on context, and that translation could be correct, but considering this is the only chapter we have to go on at the moment, I'm not convinced. So there is that as well. And I think the last criticism that all of us will agree on is Viz's choice literally not to translate their job at all. Like, their job is to literally translate and they just didn't do it. And that is the very last page, the very last spread of the chapter, where Kazuhi is running towards two hell butterflies, where it says new breaths from hell, or new breaths from hell. I'll have it on screen. However, there's a bunch of kanji that just isn't translated at all. They didn't keep the hiragana at the bottom for you to want to translate it for yourself. However, the unofficial translations go to say, you know, howling from the jaws of hell, right? Which sounds really cool. And it says arc in it. So there have been some few explanations. And one of those explanations, which I have disagreed on, is that maybe the new breaths of hell is what the arc is called. And that's what it says within the kanji, which I disagree, because new breaths of hell is written in katakana, and the katakana does not coincide with the hiragana underneath the katakana symbols, or the furigana is how many people would call it. And I'm being told it's also a very archaic way of using the kanji symbols that aren't really used in modern Japanese society. So why was it not translated? Because if that was the arc of the name, the new breaths from hell was the name of what the kanji said at the bottom, why did they keep the kanji there in the first place? I don't think I recall Viz needing to keep kanji that was already self-translated. Again, a criticism of which has confused many people, but to me, I'm convinced that these are two separate translations, and seeing as the kanji has arc within its sentence, goes to tell me that it's not the same as what we read at the top of the page. So you can have that discussion in your own time. I'm not going to disagree or agree. We'll have to just wait and see. And yes, at the last page as well, it does say the story continues, or the story unfolds and the next story to come, whatever. It's basically it alludes that there's going to be more to the story. Anyway, let's talk about the things that I'm really excited to talk about. The two controversies of which I want to talk about is Kazuhi's, I guess you could say, goldfish at the very start of the chapter, the very poeticness of talking about The two goldfish, one that was bigger than the other, and the fact that one, the bigger one died and the little one flourished from the bigger one dying, was very symbolic of, I guess you could say, that many people have speculated that because the bigger society, being the soul society in Huaycamundo and the world of the living, the bigger dimension or the bigger realm, now that that had a big hit of spiritual pressure being sent to hell, because that small society has shrunken, means that hell can grow, which is a very interesting concept with the goldfish, because one of the biggest goldfish died means that the other one could flourish. And again, I know I butchered that, but it's a very good poeticness towards it and very much fits soul society versus hell right now. Soul society is small, hell has gotten larger. However, hell still hasn't grasped the main majority of balance in this sense, because you do have Ichigo, you do have Kenpachi, you still have a large majority of captains and people that live in that side of the realm that are still powerful enough to at least restrict the gates of hell, at least enough for them not to be overrun with different hell portals, I would imagine, you know. Just bear with me on that sentiment for a second. Which is why when you watch, and Aizen got spoke about when they talked about being disappeared or vanished, as you could say, is I think in relation to, well, Aizen, he's obviously had his Ryatsu restricted, so his is being like, it's not out there, which makes the question of, well, in order for them to keep hell under lock and key, do they have to release Aizen? Do they need to get him out of the Ryashi restricting bandages for his reaction to have an effect on keeping hell's balance closed? And the same with Yuwatch is too busy keeping all the realms together because he's, you know, kind of sealed in that crystal, I guess you could say, so it's not out there being sporadic and it's not there out for the world to see. It's kind of a placeholder for the worlds to kind of coincide and connect to. That's the interpretation that I got from what Xyloporo was saying. Also, it was very interesting for me to understand how Xyloporo knew about Aizen and how Xyloporo knew about Yuwatch. Who's feeding him this information? I wouldn't imagine that the warden would tell someone like Xyloporo all this information, because why would Ukitake bring him back to hell if the warden knew that Xyloporo was bad, right? Like, if he knew he was bad and didn't want him to escape a hell, then why would he tell him this information? So the question is how did he get this information? Has he been watching from hell? Are there like fucking TV screens we don't know about? That's a really important question that I really need to know. How does he know about Ukitake? How does he know that the ritual was going on? These are very important things to know about, which we will talk about Kazui very shortly. Because Kubo likes to do this thing where he likes to mislead you, and that misleadion goes on to many different aspects, and I will give examples throughout these controversial opinions shortly. The goldfish philosophy is, I don't think, comes from Kazui. And the reason why I say this, and again, because look, listen, I'm going to go on the 90% that I'm wrong, and that's fine. I can be wrong, and you know what? I'll accept that. However, I'm going to take the devil's advocate route and say that the 10% of this first page was not Kazui narrating this. And the reason why I say this is because, one, I feel like the kid at like, what, 7 years old? It's got to be like 7-ish or something around that age. He's below 10. Would not say something as poetic as that. It's not very childlike, I believe, to say something that psychopathic. Sure, you could say there's a bit of innocence towards like, oh, I'm glad that this fish who was not so healthy got to flourish because this one died. But at the same time, I feel like there would be a certain sadness that one of the goldfish died that, you know, you looked after both. It just seemed very unchildlike and very mature in the sense of speaking for me to be convinced that it's Kazui. And I feel like that's what Kubo was trying to kind of confuse the audience to make believe that this was Kazui saying this thing, to which I don't maybe think it was. I think it was maybe someone else. Again, you can call cap on that and that's fine. I'm just giving a different perspective. So I like Kubo for doing that. I like him getting us thinking as the audience about the chapter, because it goes to be a bit more deeper than we truly thought. The next controversy would be in regards to Kyoraku and Xyloporo. And I've caught a lot of flack for this in my live reaction. Now understand that this is not an easy thing for me to explain. Again, I've known Kubo deviate many a times, and I'll give you a demonstration right after this topic. But having Xyloporo finish off Kyoraku does not sit right with me. Even though fundamentally they might be the same thing, like, yes, Kyoraku could be aware of, we might actually be sending our captains to hell, however, I'm not convinced that the context is the same. So yes, they could be saying that they're both sending captains to hell, unrealizing of it, and I agree that Xyloporo might be finishing that off. However, what doesn't sit right with me is maybe the context of what they've been doing wrong, or why they've been doing it, or why it's beneficial. However, Kyoraku could be saying, okay, yeah, we're sending our captains to hell because they would be resurrected as Hell's Wardens, right? Hell's Guards, to look after the Hollows and the bad guys, right? While the good captains would, like, keep chaos from erupting over there. That's why you see Ukitake Joshiro's sword go right through Zyle Opera to bring him back. He could be a protector of Hell and protector or a gatekeeper, so to say. And that's what could be happening to Sorippas and Shinigamis when they die, especially that powerful, because you can't keep moving that dense spiritual pressure around the different realms, right? And considering Zyle Opera has his manifestated form and his own consciousness and his own memories, goes to show that maybe Ukitake would as well. And I think people get this misnotion that people go to Hell are automatically sinners, when in actual fact it means that they may have a new duty to fulfill rather than be reincarnated into something else that the world generally can't handle. It is possible, and I think, yes, do I believe that because of the mass amounts of spiritual energy that have been going to Hell probably has disrupted the balance? Sure. I don't think it's the end all be all. I do think Kazui had something to do with it that disrupted the balance. However, I don't think Kyoraku's and Xyloporos's explanations are going to be the same. And the reason for this is, for example, you have Toshiro Hitsugaya, where you used to have those three petals that would diminish because he was, you know, inexperienced. When those petals diminished, his body would try and go into an adult form. It's like a timer. However, the enemy assumed that when those petals, you know, disappeared, that Toshiro's Bankai would also disappear. And the fans for a really long time believed that. We were absolutely in believance because the enemy had told us how Toshiro's Bankai worked, when it was in fact the wrong president to have. And thus, Zyle Opera finished off Kyoraku's statement doesn't make me think that they were talking about the same context, right? I want to know what Zyle Opera was saying to Ichigo beginning, middle and end, not the end, while I want to hear what Kyoraku has to say at the end rather than Zyle Opera finish off, because I'm not convinced. There might be a difference in what they were talking about, and that's what's important. Yeah, sure, again, they might be in Hell, but the reason for why they might be in Hell might be different, and that's why Ryuki could be worried. Oh, is Kaien in Hell? Is he a gatekeeper? Is he a guardian? Please tell me, will I ever see him again? Please tell me it ain't true. You know, you can still get the same reaction. So again, throwing out that theory out there. And again, as someone that's been reading Kubo's work for many, many years, I have seen this time and time again, and you even see it within this chapter. Kazui says, he opens up a portal and he says, don't be scared, go through this portal, everyone's there. And then literally the next page, it shows Soul Society. If that wasn't the biggest deviation ever, I don't know what to tell you, because at the start of the chapter, it's nighttime. When he opens up the portal and says everyone's in there, this is 3 hours earlier, and then we get to see Ichika, right? Fight with Madarame, like Ikkaku, and that was really fun, that was really cute. However, it's important because there is a difference in each portal, and this is why I took time to really research the difference in portals. You have the Senkaimon, which is the portal of which Soul Reapers walk through. You have the Dongai, ones without Hell Butterflies to guide them, going through the Dongai, and then you have the Cleaner. That's a different portal in and of itself. You have the Garganta, which usually follows with, you know, going from Heiko Mundo to the World of the Living, or Heiko Mundo to get to Soul Society, etc, etc. Actually, I suppose I could get to Soul Society if they wanted to, sure. And then, of course, you have Hell. Except the difference that I'm seeing with Hell is that Hell looks like a Garganta, but has teeth. And of course, going back to everything that we've seen of Hell so far, it kind of follows up with the same correlation. Again, I'll show on screen the differences. You've got the Senkaimon, and that's how that looks. You've got the Garganta, that's how that looks. You've got the, I guess, the spiral circle-y thing that Rukia and even Ichika went through. That has a certain property to it. Now you have Hell's portal, which has teeth on it, which shows Zyle Opera, and now showing Kazui. And the interesting thing is that Kazui's has teeth on it. The question then goes to, okay, so this little kid has been sending spirits to Hell. We don't know how long he's been doing this for. And another thing as well, Kon, who has been with Ichigo since the start that he was a Soul Reaper, has been with Rukia, has been to the Soul Society and back, has been in the Thousand Year Blood War Arc and has seen the Quincy's. Kon has seen so much. So for him to be scared of this shrine thing that Kazui has taken him to, open up this portal, and Kon to be scared because he's never seen it before, goes to tell me that not Ichigo, not Rukia, not the Quincy's, not the Hollows, have used this portal before. And this is completely new to Kon. He's scared. He doesn't recognize it. This is different for him. This is telling me this is a Hell Portal. I know you guys probably knew that, but it goes to solidify that Kubo's showing this through character interactions, which again is good. I would say depth towards Khan as a character, and I think he's a really good example because Khan, out of all the characters, yes, is a stuffed bear, but he's been there through the beginning. So for him to react the way he does solidifies how important that this scene actually is. So you look deeper into it. So is it possible that Kazui, who seems to be quite confident with this portal, seeing as like he doesn't change his reaction to it at all, has been potentially throwing souls in here left, right and center, causing an imbalance? Remember, in the Thousand Year Blood War arc, when Quintus were killing Soul Reapers, right, Mayuri had to go to the Rukon district to go kill a bunch of peasants within the Rukon district to rebalance the balance of scales, the life and death scales. So I mean, Mayuri is a bit of a mass murderer for no reason, but you know, he had to do what he needed to do. It's kind of the same thing, and it's very consistent with how the Bleach story is. Now, of course, people are asking if this is a Fullbring or if this Shinigami powers, because he goes out the window and he's able to turn into a Shinigami straight away. You need to understand, and I know this is a bit difficult to explain, is that Fullbring and Shinigami powers are exactly the same thing. And what I mean by this is that for Ichigo, for example, a Fullbringer needs Hollow Reishi to have powers. However, in Ichigo's case, his Hollow was his Soul Reaper Reishi. So yes, Ichigo technically was a Fullbring and is a Fullbring. However, he's not Soul Reaper and Fullbring. His Soul Reaper powers are his Fullbring powers. His Fullbring powers are his Soul Reaper powers. So they are one in the same. And I believe it's kind of the same for Kazui too, because if Ichigo had Hollow powers, then he would automatically transfer them to Kazui too. So are they Fullbringer powers? I guess you could say so, but they're not, because they're Soul Reaper powers. Because, you know, I guess it's more easy to explain once we get more information. But this is the problem with this chapter, and it's not a criticism, it's actually really good, is that this is such a setup, and this is why this needs to continue on, because you cannot have a one shot like this with this many setups and then just leave it from that. There's clearly a lot more that needs to expand it. There's a lot of questions that Kubo has left there on purpose, and there's no point in us trying to answer these questions because there's no information to go off. We just kind of gotta accept it, ride the wave, and then wait for the more information to come so we can discuss. There you go, there's some examples of deviation, there's some examples of Kazui and what he was doing. And again, bear in mind as well, because this was 3 hours earlier when we got to the Soul Society, when Kazui was opening up this portal as well, it seems to be around about the same time that Xyloporo also turned up as well, so it would make a somewhat of a connection there. Whether Kazui's used to opening up Senkai Mons, we don't know. Maybe it was just this time, wrong place, wrong time, that it conveniently opened up a Hell Portal instead of a Senkaimon. That's also a possibility too, because Hell Butterflies came out of that as well. So I can understand why there might be, maybe Kazui is a bit of ignorance towards that. But I've always noticed that through the last chapter and this chapter, every time we see Kazui do something, Ichigo and Orihime are never around. No one that's around him is of supervision. It's usually Kazui on his own. I mean, Khan's there as well, but like, even Khan was like, this seems a bit weird. Last time we saw Kazui go into a Soul Reaper outfit, you know, Ichika, Rukia's daughter, saw him. So we've never seen, you know, Ichigo or Orihime around Kazui when he's in his Soul Reaper form at all. So we don't know if he's trained. We don't know if they're accepting of him being a Soul Reaper and doing Soul Reaper duties. We don't know that. So it's a bit difficult to talk about what Kazui is and what his personality is at the moment. He is a troublemaker, we know that. Is he ignorant? Is he using Shinigami powers when he's not supposed to be untrained? That's a possibility. Could be the one to really mess this whole situation up and cause this arc to happen in the first place. Also, I feel like to solidify the Hell's Gates theory as well, there were three eyeballs within the chapter as well when Kazui opened the portals. And I think, you know, again, Khan reacting to those eyeballs was a first for him as well. And the last chapter, seeing them at the last chapter as well, is going to come up to a connection. And when we first saw Hell and Hell's Gates for the first time, we saw bandages within the skulls on the door of Hell's Gates. They seemed to be kind of static, they didn't move, they were just there like an ornament on Hell's Gates. However, it seems to me that the more spiritual energy that Hell has gotten, or the more powerful that Hell has had, it seems like those restraints, such as the bandages, have came off. And also, we now have an eyeball in one of the skeletons on the door, which goes to tell me that the more spiritual energy, or the bigger that Hell gets, maybe the more we'll see of these skeletons guarding the door revive. That could be an indication of how stronger they're getting, or maybe it's a timer on how, you know, how much Hell is growing. going. And I think to end this one off as well, I am going to leave it off with talking about foreshadowing, whether you want to class this as foreshadowing or not, because again, foreshadowing can kind of get used around about a bit too much and a bit incorrectly. And I'm guilty of this too. Back in the Soul Society arc where Ganji was talking about Kaien, he also mentions up the royalty grading system that we've come to learn, talking about how captains are grade 3 and above and how lieutenants are grade 4 to 5 and above. And this was interesting because obviously this is kind of the first that it's been really been embedded to us as the viewer, when in actual fact this was brought up way in the Soul Society arc when talking about Kaien, talking about how he was like a grade 6, right? And he, you know, he had just left the Soul Reaper Academy. He was well ready to be a nominee for an assistant captain for the 13th Barrack squad members. That was a really interesting foundation to build upon. Was it foreshadowing? Maybe not. Maybe it wasn't foreshadowing. Maybe because it's not setting up to something, but it's a foundation to a power system that was always there. And Kubo may wanted to do something with it later on, because I mean he wouldn't have brought it back if he didn't have something to plan to do with it. And this is a unit of measurement used by nobles and royalties, which I guess this is where this theory that everyone's coming from is that maybe one of the royal members is in hell. You know, maybe the fifth royal family member is in hell, and that's where we're going to see the last royal family member. It's a possibility. I'm not going to argue with that. I feel like it's a bit of a reach for now, but it's a possibility nonetheless. I'm going to end this review off here, because we've been going on for quite a while. It was an amazing chapter with high stakes and high thrills. The art was amazing, and was honestly, Kubo is just getting better and better at how he draws now that he's a lot healthier now. I hope that he continues on with this art, because he has set up a foundation which is exciting for everyone and has got everyone buzzing, and I'm excited to see where it goes. Has it been better than some spin-offs or some sequels that we've seen from other series? Yes. Of course, I think Kubo did a correct notion here. I'm bringing in new characters while not shafting the old ones. You're not alienating an audience to get themselves comfy, forcibly comfying them to these new characters while pushing the old ones to the side. No, Ichigo, Renji, all the main characters are still front and center, while the smaller, newer characters are coming in slowly and easing their way into the main cast. And I think that is the best possible outcome you can go for. Do I like the new characters? I think they've got some ambiguousness to them, and I think that makes them interesting of themselves. Is Yayahara, you know, offspring child of Urahara and Yoruichi? We don't know. I can confirm from some exclusive sketches that she does have blonde hair. So take that as you will, with brown eyes. Again, take that as you will. And we also have Atao, which is a mute person, which is very interesting because we've never seen someone write on their Zanpakuto is in on a way of calling them out before. So that's an interesting concept, and I'm glad Kubo kind of incorporated that, showing different ways that many different people use to call out their Zanpakuto. I mean, we had Kaname, who was blind, and how he saw things and how he used things as an ability. Do I think Jushiro is evil? No. Do I think he's possibly a god? Possibly. Will we see Aizen's and Jushiro's Bankai? Who knows? I think we should be asking when's the next chapter coming out first before we start asking those questions. Will we see Ukitake again, or will we see a conscious state of them? I really hope so. Do I hope that we'll get an Ede Tensei version? I really hope not. However, Kubo has done the next generation fairly successfully continuing on at the moment. So maybe he can make other characters reappear again that we thought were dead, come back successfully and within context as well. I'm hesitant on the idea. However, if you can do it well, I'm all up for it, and I'm all up for these ideas. I do have many questions about what Ichibei knows. I do think that Ichibei does have prior knowledge. He is the name of everything. He creates the names of Zanpakutos. He creates names of Kidos. Basically, everything that exists. He is known as a great five war potential for his knowledge. So he's definitely got to know a thing or two about Hell, without a shadow of a doubt. And I suppose another question is, if he was to ask me who I believe has a connection to Hell, I would say it's either Ichibei, Yamamoto, or Kenpachi based on nothing but looks, Yamamoto based off his sword abilities, talking about the flames of hell and the way he can like resurrect quote unquote skeleton warriors of enemies that he's killed in the past, and Ichibei for being able to name and give power to those Zanpakutos that can have hell within their name. Again, not really much to go off on, but it may be an indication later on down the road. Also, do I think that this is the reason why Aizen wanted to overtake the Soul King? Quite possibly. Is this why he wanted to be immortal? Again, quite possibly. Is this why Uwatch was afraid of death? Why not? Maybe. Who are we to say that it's not true? Again, these are nice theories, and there's going to be a lot to talk about. And I think the final nail in the coffin of this review is, I am so I'm so happy and I'm so pleased of the revolution that Kubo gave to us about the Hell Butterflies. I thought your watch, or Zangetsu being your watch, was one of the biggest mysteries. I also thought that Hollow Ichigo being Ichigo's his real sword and real spirit all this time was a big revelation as well. I also thought Ichigo's his mom being a Quincy was a huge revelation as well. But to talk about from the very beginning, the very first panel of Bleach being the Hell Butterfly, being that they had a bigger purpose and had a bigger overarching theme to them from the very beginning, now that is foreshadowing, and that was really, really, without swearing, really fecking good. It was really impressive, because no one on God's green earth knew that that was going to be an important factor, because they are so minuscule. We saw them all the time. There was nothing really said about them, yet we knew what they kind of did. They seemed insignificant, and that is where it has the gotcha moment. So Kubo really slapped with that. Again, a lot to take in on this chapter, and there's probably many things that I have missed. Such as, what do you think about Ichigo's sword? Do you think it's in Bankai style or do you think it's in Shikai? I don't know. And it's very apparent that Kubo did that on purpose. Kubo has made Ichigo's sword very ambiguous for a very, very long time. Even in his club Kubo, his fan club that people pay to ask questions in, he has been actively avoiding the Ichigo sword question. And that tells me is that he's not ready to explain it yet. And not ready to show it yet. Is Ichigo's sword in a fully released Shikai or Bankai state? I don't know. All that I know is that there are bandages around the handle, which there wasn't before when we first saw this form, which tells me that it is in a base state. There was an interesting theory that I did read, which that said, because Ichigo is one with his sword, means that once he had activated it, it was basically in that constant form, because he is one with it. He's not calling out a name to anyone. He is the sword, and the sword is him. So, is it in a constant Bankai form? It's quite possible. It is quite possible. So I'll leave that with you guys. If there's anything that I missed, please top it in the comment section down below and I will make a discussion video on it, because there is a lot to discuss. It is a 70 something page chapter, and I've only, as of the recording of this, have done 47 minutes of this. So edited version will be smaller. But if there's anything that I miss or anything you want to discuss, I'll let you know. Take it easy, guys. You guys, of course, have this fine day. Been handsome as always, people. Peace out. It's been such a long time since we've done a Bleach review. Since 2016. What a world we live in. Ah! Peace.